Diablo world, I've got a bit of a mess for you today. Not necessarily a bad game, but one that left me with a non-zero number of questions. This is Tango the Adventure Game, which comes to us courtesy of Gualicho Games. There is no chance I pronounced that correctly, my apologies. And is available on Steam for Windows and Mac OS X, I think. Steam page says both games' website only lists Windows, but it's a Unity engine game which can export to both platforms. It's odd. Anyway, bit of a break from the norm here, as this game is based on the life of Carlos Gardel, a French-Argentine singer, songwriter, composer, and at this point I'd just be reading the Wikipedia page out loud, so I'll stop pretending I'm smarter than I really am, and let you look it up for yourself if you're interested. Short version is that he seems to be a legend when it comes to tango music, and frankly, my knowledge of tango music doesn't extend beyond that one Tom Lehrer song. So, focusing on what I actually know, what does the game have to tell us about Mr. Gardel? Well, we open in 1930s Buenos Aires, which actually only puts us down a couple of years before the real Gardel died. And we find we're controlling the man himself. In a jail cell. I will remind you at this point that the game claims to be based on Gardel's life. He doesn't escape, meets up with a getaway driver, or maybe just a random person who drove past, it's unclear, and Carlos starts recounting the tale of how he got there. Bear in mind I said starts recounting the tale, that'll come up later. We flash back to a penniless Carlos, a Carlos recently dumped by his fiancée, a Carlos who has seen much better days. And when it comes to money, it turns out local criminals don't take credit, or at least not for very long, meaning that Carlos is all but forced to join a poker game that evening to help settle a debt, and must prepare himself for the event, mostly by getting dressed up all pretty. In the background of all this is the fiancée who fled the country, the terrible situation he's landed himself in, and, of course, Tango. It's mentioned everywhere, from the dialogue to a couple of the puzzles to the text on the loading screens, so probably important. Considering who you're playing as, that's not too surprising, but it's prevalent enough to warrant a mention. So how do you go about solving the Tango-laden puzzles? Well, it's a one-button interface with pop-out inventory. Thankfully, you can get the name of an item by hovering over it, and a more complete description is but a single click away. Not so fond of having to click and drag items to use them, but with a one-button interface you kinda have to choose between click to describe and click to select. If they weren't gonna let you use another mouse button, I'd rather keep the descriptions. And one-button interfaces do keep the door open for mobile ports, so I can see the appeal here. Not so sure what they do about the hotspot highlighting though, because that's triggered with the spacebar. Or the inventory for that matter, since you get that by moving the mouse to the top of the screen. They probably make buttons for them. In any case, you can control the game fine, it's a perfectly good interface. I mean, you can even double-click to move around faster, which doesn't work if you double-click on an exit, where I'd probably be using it most. Ah well. The main problems lie elsewhere, and they're none more obvious than the three mini-games you encounter. There's the terrible flea-catching one, which has far too much randomness and tiny targets to be fun. There's a cocktail-shaking one, which is just implementing a clue you find elsewhere with frankly, dodgy controls. It took me a couple of goes and I knew how to solve it. And there's this evil, evil whack-a-screw one. Push down all the screws, but some of those will push other screws up when you push those down. These are all timed, by the way. You get infinite retries, so the time limit ends up being more annoying than anything else. A small break from the norm is hardly a bad idea, but in the case of the first and last minigames, there's just too much punishment for not enough payoff. Another part I'm not keen on is how the game communicates information to you. It's strangely inconsistent. This early conversation, for example, it's not immediately obvious to me who's talking at one time. Sure, their names are displayed and there's a record skip whenever the guard's about to speak, but it melts into the other text. If you're wondering why some games decide to show a character portrait or colour the text differently for each character, this would be why. Later scenes do this better by focusing the camera on whoever's speaking, which shows they at least knew how to avoid these problems, consciously or otherwise. In fact, a lot of the examples I'm bringing up come from the opening areas of the game, almost as if this framing device section was a late addition. Also might explain why you start the game in a jail cell, then appear to be outside of it when you have a proper conversation with the guard. The poor communication is not limited to conversations either. The game tells me that these bars will come out with a shove, but then it makes you use an item instead of, you know, shoving them. And to get that far, I had to move a table so I could stand on it to reach the bars. Trying to interact with the pretty much within reach window didn't get me anywhere. Or there's this light switch which looks entirely out of reach. Not to spoil too much, but yeah, you can interact with the light switch that's literally around a corner. Like I said, inconsistent. For my obligatory nitpick, the loading screen displays a skip button when it's done, which made me think I was going to miss something if I clicked it. You miss nothing. Pretend the button says continue or something like that and just move on. In fact, the game will do that for you if you wait long enough. And one more stop on the negativity train, the game just kind of ends. Once you're done with the flashback, you return to the framing device, have a bit more conversation, and suddenly credits. Sure, you achieve the goal you've spent the whole game working towards and everything, but all it gets you is a vague epilogue and then it's over. And there's a couple of things that epilogue fails to wrap up, namely how Carlos ended up in jail in the first place. No climactic speech, no to be continued, it just happens. It's like a sequel hook for something that shows no other indication of a sequel. Now, despite all these oddities I've pointed out, I don't think this is a bad game. Most of the puzzles make sense, with the obvious exception of those in the opening section, and they'll have enough clues and hints to be challenging but not unfair. There's even that LucasArts technique of putting hint words in capital letters, which is a touch on the obvious side, but gave me a wee nostalgic tingle. And if you want a game that sets its tone, Tango's music does exactly that thing, in addition to being pleasant to listen to. I'm fairly sure there isn't a single Tango Tempo track in the whole game, but like I said, I'm not an expert. I hope I'm wrong on that point, because for the amount of time the game spends talking up Gardel and his influence on Tango, it would be really weird not to include any actual Tango music. In any case, it results in a light-hearted, if not 100% comedic game. It'll run the gamut from Gardel's tragic life of tragedy all the way up to a character declaring outright war on the fourth wall. I wouldn't call it full-on whiplash or anything, they spread it out adequately, just left me a little uncertain is all. The shoutouts and references I could have done without, however, most of them were on the obnoxious side. I think we're coming away with some kind of average but interesting rating, moderate fun with a unique premise. You might expect the game to try and ride on this admittedly loose association with a music legend, and in some parts of the world that might work, but most of what I said came purely from playing the game, and I had no idea this was based on a real person until I'd completed it and started researching. Therefore, anything good I've mentioned up to now is completely separated from that. Combined with the lack of voice acting, a fairly low price of £6.19, and the running time of approximately 111 minutes, yeah, I'm veering towards average to kind of good. See, there's a reason I don't have a rating system. Half the scripting time would be spent trying to assign an arbitrary number. I certainly don't think you're going to be ripped off by this one, so it might be to your liking, and hopefully you now have enough information to make your decision. Hello, thanks for watching to the end. If you're so inclined to leave a comment, a like, a dislike, whatever you fancy, please do. Or if you really like what I'm doing here, I do have a Patreon if you want to contribute money. Link's in the description. Thanks again, and cheerio.